Hello, everyone, and welcome to The Download, coming to you from our Church Milton headquarters here in the Archdiocese of Detroit. Today is the feast day of St. Peter Damian, a priest and saint the church is desperately in need of today. St. Peter Damian, a doctor of the church, waged a holy war against sodomy, which was rampant among clerics in Rome during his time. The connection to our own day is too obvious to even comment on. So today, Simon's going to introduce us to this saint, giving us a brief bio of him. Brad is going to zero in specifically on his blasting of the sin of sodomy among the Roman clergy. And Christine's going to give us a brief rundown of what used to happen to such priests when it was discovered they were guilty of a betrayal of their office. And I think it's probably safe to say that it was not that they got sent to St. Luke's in Maryland for a six-month evaluation and then returned to parish life. Let's start with you, Simon.
So St. Peter Damian, he was born around about 1007, so just after the turn of the millennium there. And he was born in Ravenna, northern Italy. Now, he was part of a large noble family, but they were quite a poor family. And his father died when he was very young, orphaning him. But an elder brother of his, of the family, took him in, but kind of abused him. He would underfeed him, mistreat him, and made him work as a swineherd. But then another elder brother, he had a lot of brothers. Another older brother took pity on him. This brother was the archpriest at Ravenna, and he took him in and he helped him out. This brother's name was Damianus, and so Peter, as a mark of respect, took Damian's name and added it to his, hence Peter Damian. Peter Damian did wonderfully in his studies of theology and canon law, and by the age of 25 was a famed teacher at both Parma and Ravenna. However, he abandoned this sort of secular teaching gig and decided that he wanted to move into a religious practice. So in 1035, he joined a monastery. Now, he had the opportunity to go into what were known as the Cluniac monasteries, which were quite famous for sort of this luxury that they had. They were very rich, they were very wealthy. It was quite a soft environment. That wasn't for Peter. He was all about the austerity, all about penance. He instituted a practice of flogging that he actually did, and self-flagellation in order to physically discipline oneself. And what he did was he spent a lot of time, in addition to the prayer and austerity in the cloister, a lot of time writing, and he did a lot of work in reforming the church. He communicated with the Pope, he communicated with the Holy Roman Emperor, Henry III, and he would address two great crimes among the clergy that he saw as being the worst. The first was the crime of sodomy and incontinence, of sexual incontinence. Brad's going to talk about his great work on that. But the other thing that he addressed was simony, which was the buying and selling of ecclesiastical offices. This was rampant at the time, and he spoke against this very, very much. But what he actually did do as well, and I think this is very important for people to realize, is that he defended the priesthood of these individuals who'd bought and sold these offices. They were priests, even though they'd kind of got it through underhand means, even though they may not necessarily fully believe the faith. And I think that, in addition to his opposition to homosexuality, is important for us to remember today.
He kept the right balance.
Yes.
Bad actor, the grace still comes through the sacraments. So you look at this and you think, this truly is the Church of God, because there is no way. All this stuff's gone on for 2,000 years, and here we still sit.
Well, first amazing thing is that you'd have a problem of sodomy back in 1049. That's a seemingly a modern issue going on here. If you look back in the logs of the history of the church, you're going to find these things are reoccurring, but they were addressed with at the time. St. Peter Damian, bishop and doctor of the church, wrote basically an open letter. It was called the Book of Gomorrah, and it was an open letter to Pope Leo IX at the time in 1049, addressing this clerical issue of sodomy. It was a part of a wider moral laxity amongst the priests around Italy at the time. And this St. Peter...
He was shocked about the Roman clergy.
Yeah.
Just the complete lack of personal holiness. All of them into, homosexual, it was sodomy, but, homosexual. He was just blown away by it.
And this is actually what he's calling out here, specifically the sin of sodomy amongst the clerics. This is what he had to write to the Pope in this open letter. He said, listen, You do-nothing superiors of clerics and priests, listen, and even though you feel sure of yourselves, tremble at the thought that you are partners in the guilt of others, those, I mean, who wink at the sins of their subjects that need correcting, and who by ill-considered silence allow them license to sin. Listen, I say, and be shrewd enough to understand that all of you alike are deserving of death. That is, not only those who do such things, but also they who approve those who practice them. End quote. Now, does he have a tone problem there? It doesn't seem very uplifting.
Can you imagine if I went on a vortex and
you
said,
deserve death.
Cardinal Dolan, you deserve death for promoting sodomy.
Oh my gosh.
Can you imagine that?
We need to do a tone check on this guy.
I actually should take a bunch of these quotes and just, for the first purposes, make them sound like they're my own.
Oh, you should. Yeah,
that would probably have the SEC down on your back. So Pope Leo IX, for his part, this was well received. Okay, he confirmed the book that this is a problem, that we're going to take action. He urged prelates to take action against this clerical sodomy. And a brief one of the parts of what he said here, he says, "He who does not attack vice but deals with it lightly is rightly judged to be guilty of his death, along with the one who dies in sin." Basically mirroring what St. Peter Damian was saying, that by your silence means consent, as St. Thomas More was talking about. If you don't correct, you... This is so necessary for our prelates today to understand this, that to stay silent is there's complicit.
Yeah,
they're
sure.
Complicit. They're complacency.
It wouldn't happen if they were to... it would happen, but it would be, squashed out very quickly, and it wouldn't grow to this cancerous infection that it's become.
That's the way it was dealt with back in the day. If, firm, we're going... But...
Oh, it was dealt with all right, wasn't it?
It really was,
They didn't just say, you can't do that. They did a few more things.
Yeah. The suggested punishment back then for a pederasty, which is... an older male cleric preying on a younger boy or teen, whatever, he was to be publicly flogged and beaten, this is in front of everybody, humiliated by his loss of tonsure if he was religious, his face smeared with spit, bound in chains, worn down with 6 months of imprisonment, and 3 days every week to fast on barley bread at sundown. And after that, he was to be confined to a monastery where he had no access to children whatsoever and under strict guard.
Where does the secret settlement come in?
Exactly.
And the mortgaging of church property to pay off the victim.
People think that's severe. Look, it's not like the Muslims, throwing gays off roofs. For them, it's just death. Here, it's some humiliation. It's 6 months imprisonment, but for the purpose of reform and also for protecting minors, protecting, young boys out there.
That last point, I was thinking, there's a long litany of stuff. If you just did that last point, you would be 1,000 times better than the church.
Yeah, but what do we have now? What do we have now, which is why it's become a cancer in the church? We've had prelates who've shuffled priests around, or said they send them off to St. Luke's for counseling for a few months, then they put them back in circulation to a parish where they can abuse again, then they're shuffled to another parish where they can abuse again. And then, right now you have people allowing the quote queering of the church all over the place. Absolutely, they would fall under condemnation.
Yeah. Sure they would.
Based on, St. Peter Damian.
Yeah, they deserve death.
And for instance, we've got Cardinal Mahoney, Now, Catholics this week, the big news was that he canceled a public appearance in the Scranton, Pennsylvania anniversary mass. And he was named special envoy to the Pope to this mass. Now, after our report, suddenly, he's canceling, and he didn't really give any reasons why. We called, we spoke to the people in the diocese, asking them, did he give reasons? And all they would say over and over and over again is, he is unable to attend. He's unable to attend. They would not answer any questions. But this is the reason Catholics were so shocked that this cardinal would have been appointed special envoy to the Pope for this is that he was guilty of covering up sex abuse for decades when he ruled L.A., and it was so bad that the police at the time even told parents who were complaining about their young boy being molested, they said, don't go to the church and tell them, go to us, so that it gives us time to gather evidence and question people, because if you go to them, immediately the machinery starts working, they start covering things up, and they send the priest away, far away, where, we can't get to them, and then they lie to us about it.
Well,
so,
on that same note there, Bishop Garcia Siller down in
San Antonio,
Took a priest in from Cardinal Supich, Cardinal Blaise Supich in Chicago, who was caught in the act of homosexual acts and all this. And how'd they handle it? Well, they gave him an evaluation, they gave him some counseling, and said, okay, that's all fine. He was returned to active ministry down under Garcia Sela.
After a year. Yeah.
After a year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So,
well, he's kicking out traditional nuns.
Yeah.
So I give you
and trying
Bernard
to destroy
Cardinal Law. I mean, come on, Bernard Law of Boston.
Yeah.
I mean, that was, you know, where the story broke, but he was absolutely the worst for that.
The only thing I did want to, when Christine's talking about that almost horrific, you know, flogging and stuff. Think of St. Thomas Becket, you know, and Henry II getting publicly flogged for the murder. But if it brings that sinner back.
Yeah.
From hell for all eternity,
yeah,
he's going to be thanking God for that discipline rather than being given some stupid time at St. Luke's Hospital, messed up even more, and returned back to ministry, where he's going to be cursing the administration for allowing him to continue in sin instead of pulling him back from it.
Yeah, this whole approach I don't know what it is. I mean, look, a lot of these guys covering up are homosexual themselves.
That's the point.
You know, they may not have been, pederasts. But they're still kind of part of the whole mindset of the gay lobby in the church. I mean, you look at the crazy, we've done a show on it, you look at the craziness going on in the Vatican right now, that gay nativity scene, what's his name, Paglia with his homoerotic painting of whatever it was, the resurrection, the ascension, whatever it was.
He set up Pontifical Academy for Life, and then just this Vatican judge and the Roman Rota. You know, right. Being convicted for child porn and sexual assault of a man.
He had like 86 child pornographic images
82.
On his laptop, mm-hmm. 82.
Yeah.
It's like, what? Why is that man even a priest still?
And he had a history with the police, too, so how was he even appointed the Roman Rota in the first place?
But he's at the Rota making decisions that affect all these
marriage.
Other cases.
Yes.
Marriage,
yes.
You're going to get someone to rightly judge.
And we still, is it the case now, as of today, we still can't figure out whether he's actually still judging or not?
No, according to one report, he has resigned.
But that's just one report that we can't confirm with any other reports.
Well, apparently a Vatican spokesman did confirm that he resigned.
Okay, all right. So, yeah, but why wasn't he removed? They knew about this years ago.
Yeah.
Why didn't they remove him?
Yeah.
So this is the whole thing.
No,
it's this
lobby.
Approach.
There's no gay lobby.
Yeah. Thank God there's no crisis in the church, Cardinal Dolan. Boy, I'm so glad when he got elected USCCB president, he made sure that we saw no crisis in the church. Absolutely not.
The guy at the road is just one example. Karamza in the doctrine of the congregation, doctrine of the faith.
Uh-huh.
And it goes back to Dario Soko.
Yeah, he was, Pope Benedict and the Polish bishops asked Father Dario Soko. We interviewed him when we were in Poland a couple of years ago, a year and a half ago. And he was a Father Oko. I think we have video of him right here. And gave us a great interview. It was in Polish. We had a wonderful translator for us, Mike. And he put together a report for the Polish bishops. But in the process of looking at just the question of homosexuality, is there something to worry about among the Polish clergy, he kind of traced things back to Rome and concludes that, about half of the clergy in Rome at the Vatican are gay. Many of them active.
And he was commissioned by Pope Benedict to find that out, and that was his official analysis back to Pope Benedict.
Remember also, with this whole question of the gay lobby that, right around in December before Pope Benedict resigns, this would be December of 2012, when that whole Vatican leaks thing was going on, and Pope Benedict appointed four cardinals to sort of do an investigation of what happened. Well, all of a sudden, they start stumbling across all this gay stuff, all these various other gay cardinals, which Pope Benedict confirmed in his book with Peter Sewalt that he had experienced a little gay lobby of four or five cardinals that he had to break up. Didn't do a very good job of it, he said. Kind of manipulating things and running things behind the scenes. And these four cardinals he had sort of set out as bloodhounds onto this whole thing. All of a sudden, from all the reports in the Italian media, because the Italian media were going, the cardinals obviously wouldn't say anything, but they knew who they were interviewing. So the Italian media went and interviewed the same people that the cardinals had interviewed. So the cardinals would walk out, the Italian press would walk in and say, so what did you tell them?
Yeah.
And the witnesses would say, well, I told them about this gay guy here and this one, and that cardinal goes into that gay club over there, and that one's got hookers, and this one has, they're using Vatican money for, and what did we find out two, three months ago? The whole gay orgy at Coco Palmiero's apartment.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's,
It's so frustrating because there are so many establishment Catholics today who remain so naive about this. Like, for instance, Steve Ray trashed you on his radio program because you had a vortex and you had studies, studies that you were looking at, reports, and you estimated possibly up to 50% of clergy are gay.
54%.
That's actually very conservative compared to if you look at the Miami Archdiocese, where one priest said if you got rid of all the gay clergy, we probably have 10% of straight priests left. And then Steve Ray just went on to say he didn't deal with the evidence that you provided. Yeah. He just went and attacked your character, saying, oh, well, you know what? I know priests, and none of them are gay. Therefore, you know, his statistics must be wrong.
Well, the Archbishop of Chicago between Bernardine and Blaise Supich is Cardinal
George.
He estimated he had a third of the priests in his diocese were homosexual.
Yeah, he told a supporter, a person who was a supporter of ours, who was also very, very good friends of his, he told this person that he couldn't, because the question came up, what about all these every flipping priest here is gay, what's going on? And he said, I can't do anything about it. You know, if I did something about him, there's a third of the priests here are gay. Mm-hmm. In Chicago, I think that's low.
I think the other thing is the problem is, despite the fact the Vatican has said gay men must not be ordained, you know, men with deep-seated homosexual tendencies must not be ordained. Their path to formation must be interrupted. You know, is the wonderful phrase.
Yeah, interrupted.
Don't interrupt it. And you know what? Possibly there's some individuals who are engaging in youthful foolishness, and you know they're still working some things out. Perhaps they can receive help and then you know get back on the path to formation. But despite the fact, very clear directives from the Vatican. These are being ignored. Right here at Sacred Heart Major, there was the note that went around, the memo that went around, essentially saying, guys, don't just come out of the shower like wearing a bath towel, you know, throw on a bathrobe or something like that, because you might become a near occasion of sin and distraction for your fellow classmates. It's like, okay, that's deeply troubling.
Yes.
Yeah, it's very troubling. Firstly,
I think it's deeply troubling on the notion that, okay, you're talking about guys who are with homosexual inclinations, and they're so homosexually inclined, they're so lacking in continence, you know, to use Peter Damian's term, that seeing a guy in a towel is suddenly a cause of some sort
coming
of thing for
out
them.
Of a bathroom, a shower,
I mean, I know for a fact that Sacred Heart Major and a bunch of other seminaries do things like, you know, football matches and basketball tournaments and all this sort of stuff. It's, you know, athleticism, because it is indoor work, no heavy lifting. You want to keep your priests kind of healthy, so you have an athletic program. Surely they're showering together. Surely they're going to the gym together. But is this, you know, and this is why you end up with the story.
This also is why you can understand that where the church's problem is. You know, a lot of people, why is the church in such a mess today? Personnel is policy. We've said that many times. The personnel are the ones who are in charge of these things are messed up. You have bad leadership right there. And I think it goes back to St. John Hughes, who said if, you know, one of the worst scourges you can ever have is to fall in the hands of bad clerics, clerical
leaders.
He said
it's a punishment for God for unfaithfulness.
For the people.
We must have been very unfaithful.
Well, it wasn't the priests who were using contraception.
And that's the point.
It was the faithful who were using contraception.
But you know what? Vocations come from the families. Yeah. And when the families are so messed up, that's where your vocations come from. And that's why you have a messed up clergy.
You know, to your point about the Vatican announcement, you know, under, I think it was 2005, I think is when that announcement came out, when Benedict was just before he became Pope, and he was still head at CDF, and they said, you know, no gay men in the clergy. Cardinal Dolan, who at the time was in Milwaukee, was the first, which I thought was very interesting, he was the very first sitting bishop in the United States to come out and say, well, we're still going to ordain gay men. It doesn't mean you can't ordain no gay men. That's not what it means. And I thought to myself, that's exactly what it means.
That's what it says.
Why are you saying that? Now, I heard that back in the time. I had just come back into the faith. I thought, that's kind of a weird thing, and I moved on from it. Mm-hmm. Now, 13 years later, look back on it, you're like, huh, little would you know that 10 years from that point, he'd be the cardinal of New York pushing for acceptance of homosexuality in the St. Patrick's Day parade. The Catholic St. Patrick's Day parade.
And it was in Milwaukee, was it last year, or just a few months ago, where the priest came out as homosexual?
Yeah.
Was he ordained by Dolan, or was he ordained by Wickham?
I can't remember. I did check that. I checked that for the Vortex. He was ordained by, what's his name?
Wickham?
Wickham, yeah.
Okay.
That's not exactly a good recommendation, though, is it?
Yeah,
really?
And Lostecki, right now, the current Archbishop of Milwaukee, came out in his defense. You know, we support him, but he needs to leave.
Yes.
He needs to leave. What is this man going to say in confession when some fellow, you know, some 15-year-old boy who's confused about his sexuality comes in and says, bless me, Father, I've sinned, I whatever with another boy or something. He's going to believe that's not a sin.
It's
and he's going
sense.
To counsel this boy, that's not a sin. You don't
Absolutely.
Have to da 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 da.
And Archbishop Lestecky, you deserve death, because that boy's soul is now threatened because of what you have allowed with this priest.
Well, St. Augustine,
this works its way back up. That's the way our Lord constituted the church, that it goes back to this point, and everybody has a share of the responsibility.
St. Augustine said spiritual murder, killing someone's life or their soul, is far worse than just killing the body.
Oh, sure.
So you're actually more guilty of condemnation.
Because it's eternal life.
Yeah.
Yeah, the interesting thing on this, trying to battle all of this today, is, you know, what is new, which is why, you know, organizations like us, LifeSide, all these places, we need to exist. Absolutely need to exist, because their evil is able to spread because of the technology. You know, certainly, you know, evil spread, but it is greatly enhanced by just push a button.
Absolutely.
You know, some evil, horrible thing happens, and there's Father James Martin, tweet, and all of a sudden 500,000 people know it.
But our presence greatly irritates them, which you can see by Spadaro wanting to censor, you know, voices that are critical.
It's just, yeah, that's that's crazy. Well, this is the condition of the world today, folks. And yeah, you know, every troubling period that the church came into was the first time it came into it, and now we have it sitting on a history shelf, and that's fine. But, you know, this too is the first time the church has ever encountered this sort of mass evil supported by this enormous technological capability. Mm-hmm. You know, communication, and, well, things like this, and LifeSite, and The Wanderer, and all these great, you know, folks who have, you know, dedicated their lives to employing this technology to battle that, this is where we are now in the church. And in one way, it's kind of exciting.
It
in another way,
exciting.
It's disgusting. That's it for today. Thanks for joining us. Please be sure and come back tomorrow for your daily dose of The Download, the most well-informed panel discussion in the whole Catholic media world. God love you.